Hey, buddy.
How you doing down there?
How are you doing down there? Yeah, man. You're cool. Look at you, little Tommy Farrell. Full suit of gold armor. Kid size. Say hi, Tommy. Welcome all of our visitors for today. Say good morning. Say good afternoon. Say happy evening. All right. He's in a bad mood, guys, but anyway, that's because I stuck him with that little funny name tag there, little Tommy Farrell. I don't know why I named him that. Sounded fun, but I literally happened to just be walking by this block, and I heard him in there, and I went and looked, and I don't know. I thought it would be cool. He needs to go hang out with our slime guys over there, so I'll see if I can somehow get that guy over there. But, you know, moving these little vicious guys around, even though he's small, he bites hard, so we got to be careful doing that. All right, guys and gals, ladies and gentlemen, children of all ages, welcome back to Camelot County. Welcome back to another episode of Let's Play Minecraft with CryinMo. As you can hear, and as you saw in the intro, we're doing some stuff with sheep today. Oh yeah, I've been breeding these guys up while I've been hammering out some wood, chopping down some trees, and breeding these guys up. I got probably enough in there that we can work with. I'm pretty excited, actually. Not for today. I'm pretty excited for like the following episode and the episode after that. I actually, in creative, have gone on and designed a lot more of our villager trading hall village, and it's going to be wonderful, and I can't wait to show you guys what I came up with. But today I realized that one of the things I need for we need it for a lot of things, actually. We need some wool, and I've been meaning, obviously, sheep farm has been on the list for a long time. We might as well build a proper sheep farm. That brings up a couple of things here. One is humane techniques, humane farming techniques. So obviously, you know, we do a chicken farm, all crammed into one space, and we do sheep farm. I googled sheep farms on YouTube just to see what was out there, and of course there's all these AFK farms, which use, I think, Exumavoid's design, which is sort of, they base it off of his design. I don't know if it's his invention or not, but I definitely remember his rainbow farm was the first time I'd seen it. But Snow Crash has a really simple, nice design that I think works really well. I was going to build that. I was going to build what I'm going to build today, which was just a regular manual, you know, sort of pastoral type, architecturally based sheep farm, you know, where we've got 16 pens with 16 different colors, so it's just a nice big rainbow sheep farm. But then I saw Snow Crash's design, and I was like, oh man, it seems more efficient, and you can AFK and collect sheep, 1,100 wool per hour. That's pretty nuts, off of 40 sheep. And I was like, well, that sounds pretty cool, and I guess, you know, we could do that and just have one sheep farm with just 40 sheep, and then we'd have to dye the wool. But then I was like, okay, well, then we have to dye the wool, and I still got to make the dye, but that would be fine. And then I thought, well, I could also, you know, make AFK farms for every color, but then that literally would be 16 AFKable farms. And that seemed, I don't know, using his build, the dimensions would actually take up the same exact amount of space as what I actually planned out for this episode. So that doesn't make any sense either, I guess, unless I really wanted to AFK, and I don't see the need to really pick up that much wool. I mean, at some point, yeah, maybe we'll need to do that. So the net result of all this thought process is I'm going to go ahead and just build a nice laid out sheep farm where we just walk in, and we have 16 pens. Each one will hold about 40 sheep, and they'll be in our 16 colors. And we got to be careful about creepers out here, because this place is not safe. One of the guys that I watch, Wells Knight, and you guys might watch him too. Yeah, so he just recently got his 100,000 subscriber. And that's pretty rad, man. He did that in 2 years. Pretty phenomenal, actually. I also found out something new today that I didn't really know was a function. And I found it out on Reddit. And it was a guy who made this little cool little invention, and it was very, very awesome, very fun. I didn't realize that water, that dispensers can fill water buckets. I guess it makes total sense, and I've used the mechanic itself without knowing I was using the mechanic. Obviously, every time I've used a dispenser with a water bucket in it, it pours the bucket out in front of it, meaning it puts the water source block in front of it, and then it sucks up the water source block. So if you have a dispenser facing an infinite water source block, then you have a dispenser that can fill water buckets up. Fall Damage 312, great little video, totally awesome and fun design, and his awesome little redstone gag, which was to fill up his water bucket when he was up in his brewing tower and he didn't have room up there for an infinite water source. So he made this little thing, and of course I'll link to it here, and he makes a little gag where you can toss an empty water bucket out of a window and a full water bucket gets thrown up to you, bounced up to you via a slime block bouncing device. And yeah, just totally, totally fun. I got a question from one of our community members here on the CryinMo channel, and he was asking me what my plans were for the series. And I do have plans for the series, and I can kind of talk about there's nothing like super specific about the plans for the series, but there are definitely I can give you my ideas. You know, I can tell you what my ideas are for where I want to go with the series. I kind of want to do a cross between Ethos and Wells Knight's series. You know, Wells Knight and B00 do this sort of thing where they, for their main Minecraft Let's Play series, they do sort of this. Their shows are specifically a building series, right? They move around their world and they build cities, towns, villages, different sort of collections of different build styles and stuff like that. Etho is more of a base builder and a redstone mechanic genius inventor. He builds like practical machines and fun machines. And Tango Tech is another guy that's sort of I want to incorporate some of his stuff. Like Tango Tech likes to build these crazy big machines, but he also builds a lot of he builds like mini games and stuff, and I think that's pretty cool. And then of course there's False Symmetry, another YouTuber I really like, who does a lot of decorative and artistic builds. She's really good at that kind of stuff. So I want my world to become like a practical kind of world that you can visit and do things in and interact with. If I go to a village, I want there to be something there that I can do there. I don't want to just be able to go there and look at it and be like, oh, this is great, this is an awesome build. I want to go there and say like, okay, we're here at this village and this is the horse trading village. Oh, there's all these horses. Oh, you can race your horses here. Oh, you can time them. That's great. Let's go to another village. What's over here? Oh, this is your villager trading area. So you can go into the nice builds, and then there's something to interact with and do there. And then, of course, at the same time, my friend MC Noodler has suggested doing something called moodscapes. And those, I think, will definitely be like these sculptures or these environmental builds where I build something. You know, for example, a moodscape might be like, oh, there's a nice lake and there are some ducks in the lake. But these are these big sculpted ducks that MC Noodler has made himself in his statue series. And I might put those out in this water and surround them with reeds or whatever, and with sugarcane. It's like this environment, like a moodscape. So when you walk through it, you kind of get this feeling of a certain type of thing. Whenever somebody downloads the world, they'll be able to go and see things and interact with all the things that we build here. That's definitely the point. The big pinnacle build idea I have, it does have to do with our menagerie that we've just started to collect with our two magma cubes, and now we have our little Tom and Farrell over here. So yeah, obviously I want to create some sort of zoo or, you know, museum. Well, it won't be a museum because we want things to be alive. So more like our zoo menagerie type thing. And I have a big plan. I have a very specific plan for what I want to do. I don't know how to do it yet. I just have an idea of what I want to create. But that, again, is like, that's like a world crowning achievement type thing. Hopefully that gives you an idea of what some of my plans are for the world itself and what I plan for the series as we go and what my build style will be like and what we can continue to look forward to. And hopefully you guys dig that. Let's get on with our build. I was looking all around. I do have a few sheep, probably have 20 sheep in a pen over at the Switch Farm, and I was traveling over there and I was like, oh, I can build it out there in the big plains that we have that's outside the Switch Farm, you know. But then we have to travel over there and everything. But then I was thinking over here and I was like, oh yeah, by the tree farm, it's on this side, we don't have anything over here. And I didn't know what I was going to build over here, And I remember, you know, just this awesome archway and everything. And what we're doing here is making this functional. We're getting the sheep pens here to where they can be functional and used quickly. But I might do some kind of overstructure. So again, this whole build is aesthetically going to be very simple, but I didn't want it to look totally terrible, so we had to redo it later on. All these guys have daylight sensors on them, of course, and they are all turned to night, but if you have a block that's not sky above a daylight sensor, I guess it doesn't matter how high up it is, it registers as night and they will stay on. So that's okay. I kind of figured, you know, the ones that are off, but I think I'm going to grow a couple of trees in here, and those might actually end up covering a lot of that anyway. As you can see, I put a vine farm over there so I could grow some farms, because I thought I was going to maybe go for sort of a rustic look in here and do like sort of rustic sheep farm type things, but I decided ultimately against that. We don't have much rustic stuff going on actually like in Camelot County, so I think we'll sort of stay away from that motif here, and we'll look forward to doing that elsewhere when we get around to building some other stuff in some other areas. We'll certainly do some rustic stuff like our pathway that takes us out to the villager trading village. That's an awesome little, you know, rustic sort of pathway, run down, beaten up, textured, that sort of thing. My idea here is, since we're going to be here in a farm in which we utilize shears, obviously this being a wool farm, and that's how you get the wools with the shears, right? Well, you also use shears to harvest vines. I'm not going to leave that one up over there. We're going to take that down. That was temporary. It was just there to grow some vines while we were at it. I finally started getting the hang of using the software called Chunky. It's a renderer, a 3D renderer for Minecraft. On average, these three images took an hour apiece, maybe an hour and 20 minutes. These are at like, I think, 1/3 the actual render resolution that can be done with Chunky, but that's plenty. I think it looks okay. But yeah, these are pretty interesting in it. I mean, the amount of time it takes to render is super tedious and really just a pain, so I won't do a ton of stuff with it. But if it was faster, of course if it was faster, I guess everybody would do a ton of stuff with it. But yeah, it seems like it has a lot of cool possibilities to do some really cool sort of Minecraft photography or Minecraft renders. I'm going to do some more with it. It's just, I basically have to like set it and forget it on the machine and not really use the machine while I'm rendering stuff. So yeah, obviously all I've done with Chunky here is I've done these big wides, which are pretty cool. And they do the, and with this depth of field applied like this, it's definitely going for the look of tilt shift photography, which is a very cool form of photography. It uses tilt shift lenses, which were originally created to sort of help photographers who take architectural photos to relieve the distortion that can, the lens distortion that can come from the curvature of certain lenses in the glass. So like you might take a picture of a super tall skyscraper and it would be sort of bowed in the photograph because your lens would actually, you know, the curvature of the glass would actually cause the image to have curves in the straight lines. But using these tilt shift lenses, which I don't quite understand how they work, but they have a little knob on the side and you can sort of use that to actuate or rotate or tilt basically an internal lens mechanism, another piece of glass in there that somehow in doing so compensates for that effect and sort of straightens the picture, straightens the lines back out. But anyway, using that tilt shift, those tilt shift lenses to take take photographs of non-architectural objects, sort of these big Ys, which they weren't necessarily intended for, they result in this sort of macro look. They kind of give the because what's happening is your eyes is your brain is seeing this large expanse, but it's seeing the shallow depth of field, which you would normally only really see in the cases if you were shooting in a miniature, because that's what would happen. Which is why in the miniature industry where I worked, to film miniatures, we had to use really long exposures. So we never filmed anything that was at like, well, very rarely did we film anything that was at like real speed. We always had to do long exposures, literally like it could be minutes per frame. Like the camera could be exposed in a single position for one frame for, you know, up to 2 minutes or something, or even longer. And what that would do is it would allow you to squeeze the iris down on your, in your lens, meaning the aperture itself, that the point that allows light into the camera onto the film, it would squeeze that aperture down. And when you squeeze an aperture down, make it smaller, the result is that more things are in focus. The wider your aperture is open, the stuff that's close to us would be out of focus. But as you squeeze that iris down to a point, just like a pinhole camera, if you make a pinhole camera with a cardboard box or something, the image that comes through that pinhole, everything's in focus, sharp focus. And that's because the smaller that pinhole, whatever it does to the light, it creates, it makes things resolve sharper in focus. And so what's happening in miniature photography, you're trying to go the opposite direction. You're trying to make everything be in focus so that it doesn't look like a miniature, because in real life, of course, buildings and stuff that are our size, everything's in focus. You know, everything is, because it's, they're big and our eyes see that. So we're just kind of relating to the way our eyes see these things. And so, yeah, this chunky render definitely makes things look like tilt shift photography, makes the houses and the buildings here look like they're miniatures, sort of, which I think is pretty cool. I really, really like that look. I really want to take a picture of like a flower up close or something and see what that looks like with maybe a building in the background. Or, all right, so I'm going to maybe grow these guys here, but I could build a structure in the middle. I might do that instead. But let's, for now, we'll just throw them all out and see. Whoa, see what happens. Yeah, something like that might happen. That's okay there. I think we can leave that there. Let's just see what happens. You know, we can just take it out. That's nice, nice, nice tall one. Awesome. See how that leaves one over the top of our daylight sensor? Turn that light on. All right, so yeah, this one could be a little taller. I would be a little happier with that. So maybe we can do this and there we go. Something like that. This is kind of weird, right? Just all the acacia trees. I suppose that's pretty strange. If we don't want to see the orange, which I'm not, it's not, we're in this giant rainbow area, so it just doesn't really matter, I don't think. I mean, there's just a ton of color splash and everything everywhere, but if we don't want to see that, I was thinking about doing this on the underside of the exposed orange acacia. Wow, that's a tall one right there, isn't it? Some of these other ones we could put leaves. There we go. Yeah, that's not too bad. Let's see, 8. I don't think we want it to be 8 block. I think we want it to be 9, but I don't know. That's pretty awesome, actually, that this area will start be getting a good use out of it. Let's read our, check our light level here. Nice, nice. Okay, it was 7 and now we're A-okay. I don't know what you guys dislike the most. I'm really not digging the spruce wood now. I don't find it attractive. I find it very dull. So I might have to pull that out. No! No! Man! This is a dangerous area down here. Dangerous area. Okay, I think we're ready here with my very makeshift way of maybe allowing these sheep to sort of populate this area. You, and we will go all the way down here. Come on. Take them all the way down to the last paddock down here, and I'll do that with a bunch of the other ones. All right, you can see, guys, I went ahead and swapped out the spruce wood slabs for the dark oak. I think it's much, much nicer, much more appetizing looking. Of course, it's hard to imagine it without all the color in it, because, of course, it'll be, you know, each one of these will be an array of carpet color around, so it'll look more like this over here. And of course I missed this row right here, but I'll have to go in and take all these out. I didn't even do the second half. There's you know, 8 more paddocks over there that I have to go and remove the spruce wood slabs from. and replace with the dark oak. All right, well, guys, thank you so much for hanging out today. I know this is kind of a weird episode, kind of a weird farm to make here. It's not super awesome, just a typical manual sort of rainbow wool farm, but it is prime for maybe something around the edges, something to house it in. I'm not sure. I could build a building around it, or I could just build a little wall. I think a little decorative wall might be fine. Something rainbow colored maybe, or something. I'm not sure. But obviously, you look over here, you can actually see the scale of it. You can see all the colors coming in. That's pretty nice where you can see that. So when we're up in the tree farm area and we're cutting down our big trees and everything, when we get to this end, we'll be able to look out and see the whole farm, all the rainbowness of it all. And it looks pretty nice. So yeah, it's kind of cool. That's it for today, guys. This was a very long episode for me to make. I was not prepared to do it. As I said, I was really excited to do what's going to happen next episode because I'm all planned for that. I already have the materials and everything gathered. Thank you so much for hanging out. I hope you guys have a great couple of days and a great week. And I will see you later on here in the Camelot County with CryinMo. That's me. See you guys later. Take care. Bye-bye.